So dear all, this is Dr. Atish Mundra, Associate Professor in Pharmaceutics with SNJB Sriman Suresh Dada Jain College of Pharmacy, Chandwad, has come up with next topic, that is course dispersion. In this particular topic, we'll be going through course dispersions, namely suspensions, emulsions. In suspensions, we'll be talking about interfacial properties of the suspending particle, settling in suspension, how it happens and what are the different parameters which needs to be taken care of, how you can go with formulation of flocculated or deflocculated suspension. Flocculated and deflocculated are the two types of suspensions, and you must be knowing the basic difference. In case of deflocculated suspension, particles are individual. They require a lot of time for settling down. But unfortunately, when they settle down, they may lead to the formation of hard cake, which is actually unacceptable. And that's why flocculated suspension, in which the particles are breached to each other and they looks very much similar to the flocks, and that's why they are known as flocculated particle. The rate of sedimentation of flocculated suspension is a bit higher as compared to deflocculated one. But whatever the disadvantage which we know about, that deflocculated suspension forms hard cake, that can be avoided in case of flocculated suspension. So we'll be talking about formulations of both type of suspensions, lab scale as well as large scale, how these suspensions can be produced. Then moving ahead, we'll be talking about emulsions, which is second type of course dispersion. We'll be dealing with the theories of emulsification, how emulsions can be formed using HLB method, means different surfactants are there which can give rise to different type of emulsions. There are surfactant which are lipophilic in nature, we will give rise to WyO type of emulsion. The surfactant which are hydrophilic in nature will give you O by W type of emulsion. Then we'll be talking about how these rheological properties of the emulsions play an important role. Preservation, how preservation of emulsion can be carried out. And we'll talk about how you need to be careful while going for the stability or stabilization of emulsion. In emulsions, the different types of emulsions are there. We have micro emulsions, we have multiple emulsions. We'll be talking about that as well. So let us start first with suspensions. Before going actual for suspension, let me tell you about what course dispersion means. Previously, we have seen there are three types of dispersions. And this classification or discrimination between these three types is being made on the basis of the particle size of the dispersed phase. Based on the particle size of the dispersed phase, there are three types of dispersions: molecular dispersion, colloidal dispersion, and coarse dispersion. Dispersion itself is a heterogeneous preparation where it is made up of two different phases. The one which is internal phase is also known as dispersed phase, and the external phase is also known as continuous phase. So in coarse dispersion, the particle size of a suspended particle is greater than 0.5 micron or it is 1 millimeter. And in coarse dispersion, we have two important examples. One is suspension and another one is emulsion. Our pharmacy field will be void if we won't talk about suspensions and emulsions. The way tablets and capsules are integral part of pharmacy, similarly, suspensions and emulsions are also an integral part. Suspensions, these are the class of dispersed systems in which a finely divided solid is being dispersed uniformly in a liquid dispersion medium. Now, when you are talking about solid materials which are dispersed throughout a liquid medium, it means the solid material which is being dispersed is insoluble in the given solvent, and that's why instead of giving your solution, it is leading or giving rise to the suspension. And to have a uniform dispersion of the dispersed phase throughout the liquid dispersion medium, it is the critical job to be performed by formulator while formulating the suspension. It should not happen that the uniform dispersion of the dispersed phase is not taking place, and it may lead to the wrong dosage when the consumer is taking out the preparation. So with slight shaking, no doubt, as we are going to formulate suspension containing insoluble solids into a liquid medium, the solid particles are going to settle down because of the force of gravity. But with slight shaking, the dispersed phase should come back to its dispersed state. And this is possible in case of flocculator suspension. With slight shaking, you can bring back the dispersed phase into the uniform dispersed state. It may not be possible if complete settling of the particles has taken place into deflocculated suspension. And that's why flocculated suspension will be preferred during formulation because of this particular advantage. Now, depending upon their intended use and route of delivery, the suspensions are broadly classified into three important categories. One is parenteral suspension, second one is topical suspensions, and oral suspensions. Now, basic difference between parenteral and other two types of suspension is in the size of the viscosity of the dispersion medium and how much amount of this dispersed phase can be added. Physical characteristic of a suspension, it depends upon the intended route of delivery. If you are talking about, say, oral or topical delivery of a suspension, it can be made of high viscosity, and that's why it may contain a high amount of dispersed phase. In case of parenteral suspension, as we know, it needs to be syringeable. The viscosity needs to be low and the solid content should be less than 5%. So this is the basic difference between the types of suspension. If we know that we need to prepare a parenteral suspension, that time we will have to be careful that viscosity of the preparation should not be high, and the solid content for parenteral preparation could not be more than 5%. The reason behind this is the syringeability of preparation when you are trying to administer it parenterally. In case of oral suspension, we know that the high viscosity and high amount of dispersed phase can help us in allowing the maximum point of contact between our preparation and the absorption sites. And that's why oral suspension generally have high viscosity and also contain very high amount of the dispersed solids. There will be different reasons for the formulation of pharmaceutical suspensions. First one, the drug is insoluble in delivery vehicle. So there could be different reason for going for the formulation of pharmaceutical suspensions. The very first and obvious reason is that the material or the API which you are trying to deliver through this particular dosage form is insoluble in the delivery vehicle. So when solids are insoluble in the given solvent, at that time formulation of pharmaceutical suspension is only choice formulator have. Next one is, if the API is very bitter in taste, at that time the taste of that drug can be masked with the help of various sweetening agents and other flavors and other agents which can help in masking the bitter taste. It also increases or helps in increasing the stability of the drug, and even pharmaceutical suspensions are preferred and used when you are interested in increasing or getting the control or sustained release of your API into the body. Ideally, The internal phase should be dispersed uniformly throughout the dispersion medium and should not sediment during storage. But this is very ideal condition, and we know ideal things do not exist in the universe. Similarly, this is the ideal thing which we are expecting, that dispersed phase should not at all settle down. But gravitational force is going to work on its own. It is not going to listen to anyone. So what you are thinking and what you are expecting may not work. And that's why this is practically impossible, that particles will not settle down. Particles in the suspension, they possess surface free energy that makes the system unstable, leading to particle settling. The free energy of the system, it depends upon the total surface area and the interfacial tension between the liquid medium and the solid particle. And if we want to reduce this surface free energy and to reduce the rate of sedimentation, then we can decrease the surface area, which can be achieved by formation of agglomerates. And this is another reason because of which we can say that the flocculated suspension will be preferred during formulation of pharmaceutical suspension, wherein we can minimize the free energy and ensure that the rate of sedimentation can be lowered down because of the reduction into the surface area of the particles. So what are the important considerations which are there during the formulation of a suspension? Formulation of a pharmaceutical suspension, it requires a knowledge of the properties of both dispersed phase as well as dispersion medium, because these are the two integral parts of pharmaceutical suspension. And unless and until we know about the properties of dispersed phase as well as dispersion medium, it will lead to disaster. And knowing the properties, will be able to select proper dispersed phase and a proper dispersion medium for the dispersed phase to ensure that uniform suspension can be obtained and it can be maintained in its stable form. So very first thing is nature of the suspended material. The API will play an important role, because based on the API only, you will be able to select a proper dispersion medium. So first one is your nature of suspended material. The interfacial properties of the suspended material are important consideration during the formulation of a suspension. Particles that have low interfacial tension, they are easily wetted by water and therefore can be suspended easily. But let me tell you, we are talking about insoluble solids, and that's why the interfacial tension between the dispersed phase and dispersion medium is going to be quite higher. And this is the reason because of which we go for using some surfactant, which are also known as suspending agents. So particles of materials with high interfacial tension, as they are not wetted easily, we need to take help of some kind of agents which will reduce this interfacial tension. And who else can be the better excipient for serving this purpose other than surfactants? So the suspensions of such materials can be normally achieved into a given dispersion medium with the help of a selection of proper or suitable surfactants. Surfactants increases the wettability by reducing the contact angle between dispersed phase and dispersion medium by reducing the surface tension. As we know, surfactants, the name itself indicates, they are the agents which are active onto the surfaces. So they cover the surface of the solid particle, which is insoluble, into the dispersion medium and tries to increase the interaction between dispersed phase and dispersion medium by reducing the surface tension which exists between those two. Second one is the size of the suspended particle. Reduction of particle size, it leads to decrease in the rate of sedimentation of the suspended particle, as it is being explained by Stokes' law. We know in Stokes' law, DST is on the numerator. So if we want to reduce the rate of sedimentation, we will have to ensure that the particle size needs to be reduced. we know Stokes' law, V is equal to H by T. So is equal to square root of DST square. So DST stands for diameter, Stokes' diameter. And when it is on the numerator, it means if we want to reduce the rate of sedimentation, we'll have to reduce the particle size. And that will help us in reduction of the rate of sedimentation. Reduction in the size of the particle, it can be achieved by processing like milling, sieving and grinding. But let me tell you, when we are trying to reduce the particle size, on the other side, we are increasing the surface area. So it is like a rope walk for a formulator. On one side, you are taking care of rate of sedimentation or reduction into the settling down of the particle. But on the other side, simultaneously, you are increasing the surface area. Increase into the surface area will lead to increase into the surface tension between dispersed phase and dispersion medium, and will lead to improper interaction that is taking place between dispersed phase and dispersion medium. So you have to be very careful while reducing the particle size. It should be, and another disadvantage of reducing particle size to very great extent will lead to development of some kind of static charges onto the particle, which ultimately will lead to increase into the contact angle between dispersed phase and dispersion medium, and making it impossible of interaction between dispersed phase and dispersion medium. So reduction of a particle size is recommended, but it has to be done judiciously to ensure that on the other part, we are not trying to increase the surface tension and contact angle. Particle size also affects the rate and extent of the absorption, dissolution and biodistribution of the drug. We know that as we go on reducing the particle size, ultimately, we may increase the rate of absorption and dissolution because of the increase into the surface area and increase into the chances of interaction between your API and the absorption site. However, reducing particle size beyond a certain limit may lead to a formation of compact cake upon sedimentation. And that is why I said we need to be very cautious and judicious enough to ensure that how much reduction into the particle size we are going for during preparation of a pharmaceutical suspension. Now, third important thing in the formulation consideration of a stable suspension is viscosity of the dispersion medium. As I said earlier, if we are going for oral or topical suspension, then viscosity could be higher because we want that rate of settling of particle should be slowed down. However, if we are going for parenteral preparation, at that time, you cannot increase the viscosity beyond one extent because you have to be careful and know about the syringeability as well. So greater viscosity of the dispersion medium, it offers the advantage of slowing or lowering down the rate of sedimentation. However, on the other part, if we are talking about parenteral preparation, you have to be careful and take this thing into account that syringeability should not be compromised. Even spreadability for topical suspension or ease of administration of oral suspension should also be taken into account while increasing the viscosity of dispersion medium. As I said earlier, we are interested in reducing the rate of sedimentation, but while achieving that particular goal, it should not happen that we are increasing the viscosity to such an extent that we are not able to take out the preparation from the container during the administration, or it is so viscous that we are not able to spread it onto the skin if it is topical application, or if it is parenteral preparation, then it is not getting out up to the of the needle and it is not having that syringeability. So all these three important things should not be compromised while taking care of increasing the viscosity of the dispersion medium to decrease the rate of sedimentation. The property of shear thinning is highly desirable. We have spoken about this in rheology, that pseudoplastic systems where the viscosity of the preparation could be higher when the preparation is at rest, but with slight shaking, the preparation is getting into the state where the shear thinning or lowering down of the viscosity is taking place. So if that property could be imparted to the preparation, then it can help us that suspension will be highly viscous during storage, wherein with minimal shear, it will go back to the flowability state and could be sprayed easily, could be taken out of the container easily, or even it could be easily syringed or administered through the syringes. So this property, if we can impart to our preparation, if we can apply our pharmaceutical knowledge, and if we can convert our preparation into pseudoplastic system, then we can achieve both of our goals. First goal, decreasing the rate of sedimentation, ensuring that the preparation will be highly viscous during storage. So when minimal shear is there, it is having good viscosity and particle settling or rate of sedimentation is being slow or low down. And when we are agitating the container, or when we are agitating or shaking the bottle of the preparation, the viscosity will be low down and will ensure or will facilitate the ease of pouring of the content from the container, or ease of spreading of the preparation onto the skin, or ease of syringeability of the content through the needle while administration. So these were the three important considerations we should be worried about while going for selection of proper dispersed space, dispersion medium, and at the same time, whatever viscosity modifiers which we are going to use, they should be chosen judiciously to achieve the goal which are there in front of us. And these goals varies depending upon the route of administration of our preparation. Parenteral, you have different goal. For topical, you have different goal. For oral, you have another goal. In case of parenteral, the goal is preparation should be stable. At the same time, it should be syringeable. For topical preparation, again, it needs to be stable, uniformly dispersed phase throughout the dispersion medium, but the spreadability of the preparation should not be compromised. And in case of oral preparation, viscosity should be higher, so that rate of sedimentation will be slowed down, but the preparation should be easy to pour or taken out of the container during administration. So these were three important considerations which should be taken into account while going for the formulation of suspension. Now, as we spoke regarding the interaction that are going to take place between dispersed phase and dispersion medium, so most important property which is going to be there into the picture is the interfacial properties. How suspended particle exhibit interfacial properties. Interface, we know what do you mean by interface. It is the boundary which discriminate between two phases. So here you have two phases which are going to be there in contact with each other for a prolonged period of time throughout the shelf life of the preparation. One is your solid state and another one is your liquid phase. Solid state, which is dispersed phase, liquid state or liquid phase, it is the continuous medium or external phase. In pharmaceutical suspensions, the solid phase remains as a finely divided particles in the dispersion medium, and therefore large amount of interface is involved in the formation, which in turn affect the stability of suspensions. We know that the boundary of the phases has different properties, and when this interface is going to be enormous while formulation of a suspension, you have to be very careful, and you should take this interfacial properties into account if we want to prepare a very stable suspension. The interfacial property will play a vital role in modifying the physical characteristics of the suspension and giving us a very stable and uniform suspension. The two most important interfacial properties include surface free energy and surface potential. We have seen what do you mean by surface free energy and surface potential in interfacial phenomena. Surface free energy is the free energy which is associated with the molecules which are there onto the surface. And why this kind of energy is required with the molecules which are there onto the surface? Because they are experiencing the different environment, when the material or when the molecules are there into the bulk, they are being surrounded by the like molecules. But when molecule come onto the surface, it is going to experience the different environment. As I said earlier, when we are there at home, we are very safe. When we go into the market, we are at risk. Same kind of thing is there when material or molecule of any particular phase, it is there into the bulk of that particular phase, it is safe because it is surrounded by its own molecule. When it comes onto the surface, then it is going to experience a different environment because it is making contact with the molecules of the another phase. And that's why there has to have some extra energy associated with those molecules, being this is the free energy which is associated with the molecules which are there onto the surface. It is also known as surface free energy. And the potential of a surface is altogether different. We have seen the molecules which are there onto the surface, they are always experiencing the tension or net inward pull. So the potential of a surface is different, and these two important properties should be taken into account while going for formulation of a stable suspension. A large surface area which is offered by finely divided solid material is typically associated with large amount of free energy on the surface. Because in case of liquids, we have seen when liquid comes out of an aperture, it tries to assume the spherical shape to have its minimum number of molecules exposed onto the surface, because sphere is said to be the only shape in which minimum number of molecules of that particular liquid will be there exposed to the different environment per unit volume. Let me tell you, sphere is the only shape which has minimum surface area per unit volume. And in case of solids, when we are dividing it into smaller particles, ultimately we are increasing its surface area. Increasing the surface area, it means we are making sure that more and more number of molecules of that material will be exposed to the different environment. And ultimately, when more and more number of molecules are getting exposed to the molecules of the another phase, it is going to increase into the free energy of the surface as well. This large amount of free energy, which is associated with the surface, it is going to create problem for the stability of your suspension. And system with very fine particle is, because of this particular reason, is always thermodynamically unstable. And that's why you must have seen that whenever we define suspensions or emulsion, we do mention this particular thing into the definition, that these are heterogeneous systems which are thermodynamically unstable. Why they are thermodynamically unstable? Because of very high surface free energy. What this means, that every molecule will try to agglomerate, to come closer to their own molecules to reduce the surface free energy. So agglomeration or caking is common in case of suspension. When suspensions are being kept undisturbed onto the shelf, agglomeration of the particles may happen to reduce this high surface free energy. And that's why it is being said that systems with very fine particles are thermodynamically unstable. Because of this total surface area, molecules will try to come closer to each other to reduce this surface free energy and to achieve the stability. So when we are reducing the particle size, as I have said earlier, that reduction of particle size to one particular extent is advisable, will be recommended, which will increase the interaction between the dispersed phase and dispersion medium. But if you go on decreasing it to very high extent, then it may revert back and give us a boomerang kind of thing, where instead of achieving the stability, you are making suspension thermodynamically unstable. As it is being said, everything is in limit is advisable. Whether you are eating sugar, whether you are eating proteins, or whether it is consumption of a fat. If you go on increasing the consumption beyond one particular limit, then it is going to have deleterious effect. Marathi mein bolte hai, Marathi tek mane, ati tete mati. So if you try to exceed the limit, then you will find that instead of achieving the stability, you are actually ensuring that the suspension will be more and more unstable, and it will be unstable because of increase into the surface free energy. Mind it. Then system tends to agglomerate in order to reduce, as I said earlier, to reduce the surface free energy and surface area. Materials will try to agglomerate to come closer to each other. Surface free energy may also be reduced to avoid the agglomeration of particle, which can be accomplished by reduction in the interfacial energy. And for sure, who else could be the best material to reduce this particular property or interfacial energy is your wetting agents. The surfactants having HLB value between 7 to 9, they are used as wetting agents. So when wetting agent is being added to the suspension formulation, it will be adsorbed onto the interface, will result into the reduction of interfacial tension, making the system more stable. And this is where the wetting agents or the surfactants which are used as wetting agent play an important role, giving us a stable suspension. Surface potential exists when dispersed solid particles in a suspension possesses charge in relation to their surrounding liquid medium. We have seen in colloids that how particles can acquire charge. So if there are some charges onto the particle, then it will lead to development of surface potential, which will lead to improper interaction taking place between the dispersed phase molecules and dispersion medium molecules. Solid particles may become charged through different ways, and if suspension contains electrolyte, selective adsorption of particular ionic species by solid particle is the possibility. This will lead to formation of charged particles, and once particles are being charged, they will start repelling each other and ensuring that uniform dispersion of the dispersed space. So sometimes providing charges onto the particle can also help in increasing the stability of a given suspension. I hope the things which have been explained today must have been clear to each and everyone. In another lecture, we'll be talking about types of suspensions and their preparations as well.